I think there's actually a few different ways to even think about what composable data means in Web3. There's two ways that it actually breaks down. One is it's data that you create in one application, potentially being useful in other applications in the future because you have the access control over that data. And that weaves into ideas like self-sovereignty and data sovereignty. There's another totally different sort of tract of ideas around composable data. And that gets into an older topic of data liquidity. Data liquidity has typically been within an organization. So you imagine a very large organization. They might be creating data across many different compartments of the organization. Data liquidity has meant how easily can those compartments move data around. Now, I think it's really exciting to think about the organizations in Web3 being able to adopt that same approach. So can one DAO be creating data around reputation that is stored and manipulated in such a way that another DAO can come along and read it and feed into things like membership proposals or external proposals for new work of that DAO? Those kinds of ideas lean heavily on composability. My name is Andrew Hill. I'm co-founder of a project called Tableland. We're building a database layer for Web3. Let me actually pin the story on data. So in the early days of blockchain and the early days of smart contracts, there really was no data. And so the solutions that we saw to actually serve data were fairly straightforward. So in smart contracts, you can store data in basic maps and key value stores. And the way that you actually pull that data out is fairly rudimentary. You look it up by key, you pull it back out, and that's about what you get. As the ecosystem evolved, we saw a number of solutions come about to work with data on top of that. So in the early Web3 days, we saw purpose-built networks that solved the problems of general data. So how do you put data next to the protocols that are running the blockchain? And so some good examples of this at the time were like IPFS and the graph. They solve, basically you can put any kind of data in there and they serve the needs of that kind of data. So what we saw is like the boon of NFTs, for example. So many NFTs have their raw data existing as a JSON file on IPFS. And that works really well for that use case. But now as the ecosystem is evolving and trying to do a lot more with the data, trying to build really robust applications, trying to build interactive applications, trying to do more with what it means to own an asset and be able to modify what's underneath that asset, you need a more robust database to handle that. So as the community has explored what you can do with the existing technologies, they've also been trying to figure out how to sort of breathe new functionality into the things they're building. So if you imagine just having an NFT that you now want to be playable in a game, what does it mean to be playable? Well, it means that you might have different people that can modify different attributes of that NFT. You might have the owner who can modify what weapon their character is playing in a game. And then you might have the game creator who might have control over what level that character currently is on based on what they've played before. And that sort of mixed connection to the data and being able to modify it takes a database that works very natively to the protocol and the idea of ownership and signatures of the wallets of those two participants. And so what we're seeing is that a lot of people are trying to now innovate on, say, NFTs, and they're looking for this more advanced database. Another really concrete example is now going out a step further. So what we've seen this community do really well is sort of create community conventions around the data that they're storing. And so an NFT is another great example of that. We have the standard for the metadata that backs most all NFTs, most all ERC-721 NFTs. And that's mostly a convention that if it's adopted by wallets and marketplaces, it means they all display the same NFT and can sort of sort and filter the different properties of that NFT. But we haven't made many conventions for more complex structures. So a great example of that would be a DAO. We haven't seen many data conventions arise around how DAOs are storing the information around roles and memberships and contributions and even votes are fairly scattered. Part of that is driven by the fact that there aren't shared databases across DAOs. And so we're seeing a lot of use cases in this sort of advanced NFTs that want mutable traits, playable NFTs, DAOs, and now we're actually starting to talk to projects that are using decentralized storage networks. So trying to build data pipelines and build ownership over storage records and lots of really kind of interesting added functionality on top of the data that you're storing. One of the really interesting things that happens is as a developer, you start creating and trying to interact with more intricate or rich data structures, the models that you're storing data in a database, you can no longer just look up data by a key and always get what you're looking for. And so one of the next sort of innovations on top of just bringing a database to Web3 is bringing the lingua franca of interacting with data to Web3. And that traditionally outside of Web3 has been a language called SQL, structured query language. And in pretty much every developer stack, a developer is going to be interacting at some level with SQL. But so far, SQL doesn't really exist natively in Web3 in any place to interact with data. And so without that data-specific language for creating and modifying records in a database, it again sort of limits what a developer can quickly build and compose and layer on top of. And so that's the next sort of innovation that we're going after. We can build databases that are centralized and have APIs and can serve the needs of application developers on the internet pretty effectively, and there's a lot of companies that do that. But actually building a database that runs as a protocol that's incentivized on a network and actually lives next to the smart contracts that people are writing does a lot of really interesting things, and actually it kind of gives the database superpowers. So it allows you to program the database using all the ownership and identity records that you have on the blockchain already. So for example, in a database connected to a smart contract, you can actually use the smart contract to write rules around how specific rows or cells in that database can be changed and who can change them. And those rules can be immutable in such a way that you can be certain that that data will only ever change by the owner of a specific NFT or by the holder of a specific wallet address. And those kinds of things are just building blocks that then can be layered on top of each other to build really interesting and intricate ways of manipulating and using data in a database. Now, the next step, sort of once you have the database in Web3, we can imagine a lot of people actually creating data in those databases. What we're really interested in are a flavor of databases called relational databases. And so there's a few ways to think about relational databases, but maybe the most helpful is actually just saying it's a bunch of tables, just like you've experienced in probably spreadsheets, either, you know, Excel spreadsheets or Google Sheets. You have a table, you have columns, you have rows, and the values, the data that are in those tables are typed. So you have strings, you have integers, you have Booleans, things like that. When developers create those tables and the types for all of those columns, we call those the data model. The data model itself becomes this really important foundation, because if you and I are building wildly different projects but rely on similar data, if we're storing it in ways that are adopting the same models, suddenly somebody can come along and look at our projects from the same lens, use that SQL language to interact with the two data sets, bring them together, and potentially build totally new things on top of that data. I think that this idea of getting the database and this idea of data models and these ideas of composability and this idea of programmable access control, all of these ideas come together and actually point towards what I think could be sort of the holy grail of data for the internet. Yeah, I got my start working on this over 15 years ago, studying to be a biologist and getting really interested on how we could bring together data sets that were stored around the world about biodiversity. And how could we bring those data together to more quickly inform scientists and make decisions about how biodiversity was changing, how ecosystems were changing, and what we needed to potentially do about it, or what were our priorities for doing on-the-ground research. And that idea of turning data into information and information into knowledge has been always such an exciting idea. And I think Web3 is in this amazing position to actually bring new kinds of data into those same flows. So how can we collectively create data we can all together turn into information and into knowledge? And for me, that seems like a worthwhile mission in Web3.